Hey you all, good morning you all. Welcome back to the channel. I really do appreciate you watching. This video, I'm going to show you guys how to take a chunk of wood and turn it into a glut hammer. How many of you people know what a glut hammer is?
I know you've seen pictures of people splitting fence rails, especially Abraham Lincoln. You'll see a picture of him with a big old hammer. Splitting rails, that's one of the things that they did back in those days. All the way up into the 1800s, they would take chestnut trees, chestnut oak, and chestnut trees, and they would split rails out of them to make fences with, so stack those fences. So I'm going to make a hammer out of wood, just like they used back in those days, and I'm going to show you how to do it, because not everybody back in the pioneer days had a sledgehammer that was made out of metal. That was just not really, really common. But what they would do, they would make them a glut hammer. They would then take the hardest wood they could find. Usually it was dogwood. They would make dogwood wedges and they would split the rails. So I'm going to show you in this video how to make this hammer. All right, you all, there's our hammerhead. These can be any size your arms want to swing, okay? If you're Paul Bunyan, you can make one as big as a dad burn tree. Mine is 8 inches long, and now it is 4 inches around. So I've got to drill a hole in it so that I can establish how the handle is going to work. Now this thing is still wet, you all, so you'll see some steam. Now you all, a lot of these hammers, you see he's got a square handle in them, okay? Go all the way through the head. This one's not going to be like that. Now, you all, one of the reasons I'm making this green is when you put your handle in here, this green hole will shrink up around your handle, okay? And I did have to break out the big guns on this, you all. This old drill right here I bought back in, I think like 1980 or maybe a little bit earlier. This is a Sears half inch drill. That's when Sears really made tools. Okay, we're 2.5 inches in there, you all. That's deep enough. That's what it looks like, you all. Good old glut hammer. All right, let's whip us out a handle for it out of hickory. You all, I measured us up a 36 inch handle here. All right, you all, I measured us up a 36 inch handle here. When you're splitting rails out of this stuff, you don't want to be bending over splitting, okay? You want to be able to stand up straight and hit your glut that's in your log. And there were, you know, multiple gluts in the log, so you didn't want to have to stop and bend over and move or do anything like that. You got your glut started, then you could just stand right up and you could just reach out and hit those gluts. By the way, you all, right there is a dogwood mallet, hand mallet, carver's mallet, that I made on video. This is made out of dogwood. It does not have a crack in it, you all. That's why dogwood, if you can find it, is such a very valuable piece of wood to use for that. So you all, we've got our caliper set for the hole size. This is critical on this right here, because this right here is not very deep at all. So this is probably you all gonna do a lot of vibrating. All right, that should work just fine. You all, these would have been made in the field. A draw knife, hatchet, axe, and a knife. And I'm just taking advantage of this wood lathe since I've got it. So now what I need to do, you all, is see. You can see it's still crooked, but I'll show you how to fix that in a minute. That's no big deal whatsoever. All right, let's take a test run and see how close we are right here. Oh yeah, we're really good. Really good and close. Right on the money, as a matter of fact. So I'm going to show you a trick here, you all, to keep that handle in this head without driving stuff through the side of it. Because if you do that to these kind of hammers, you're going to make a place where it's going to crack, okay? So we don't want that to happen.
All right, you all. I've got a wedge. When you put this wedge in this handle and you drive it down inside that hole, it will spread out at the right length. And make sure it's exactly the right length. I need to cut that one off a little bit. What happens then is when this wedge spreads out and this thing tightens up, this can't pull back out of there because of the wedge that's in it, okay? The wedge won't let it come back out. Now you see them through wedges where it goes all the way through your handle? This one's called a disappearing wedge. And like I say, it needs to be cut off just a little bit so that it don't come down here and crack the handle. And of course, I'd like to thank my wife, Miss Libby, for giving me this safety gear, because I can tell you right now, it sure does come in handy, especially when you're sanding. It looks weird, but breathing dust is a whole lot weirder.
I'll give you a little shot of how that's going to look, okay? You want that sticking up right there in your slot. Not drove in there because it's not going to go in. But as it goes in and bottoms out, this will spread out. And then the wedge can't slip back, period. Okay, it's stuck. So let's hammer that thing in there and see how she's going to work. Wooden hammer. That big old boy, Abraham Lincoln himself would have liked that hammer. Now, when that shrinks up, you all, that ain't coming out of that handle, okay? This is going to shrink around this piece of wood. The wedge is in there, and that ain't coming off. What do you think about that hammer, you all? Just don't let your wife get a hold of it, okay, you guys? If you make one of these, because, you know, sometimes you get a little cranky and she might bust you right in the skull with it. Anyway, check this out now. These things would have been traditionally made, you all, by a blacksmith or in a carpenter shop somewhere for the people who are going to use them. They would take a piece of crotch wood or a burl off of a tree, but a good piece of oak, crotch wood, especially, let's say white oak crotch wood, that's where your pieces come together. You got a big chunk there that's got that grain running in every direction. They would make them out of them, and the things would just last forever. But now, if a blacksmith did it, they would forge a metal ring to go around the end of these right here so that they didn't have a tendency to split apart. So once this handle here, this hammer dries out, I will forge two rings and I will put them on there so that it will look like that traditionally made blacksmith hammer, okay? So that's what it looks like. Now, one thing I want to show y'all. See how crooked that handle is? That really is not that crooked since I turned it, but it's still got a crook in it. All you've got to do, you all, to straighten these things, this handle out, is saturate that thing in water and put it in a vise and then hang you some weight on it until it gets to gets straight. Okay, y'all, start to finish. Went to the woods, cut the tree down. Well, actually, it's just a block of firewood right here. Went and got a hickory sapling, about 2 inches through. Start to finish, this probably took me 2 hours, okay? And I don't think you can beat that right there with a stick. And this is a stick. Now, for you people who are going to go out here and make you one and then you're going to start using them to do something with, you can still use these wooden hammers for, if you've ever watched the Barnwood Builders, that's really where I got the inspiration to make one of these hammers, because they got two or three of them that they reach up there and they hit a big old timber with, and they might just be trying to move it about 3/4 of an inch or something. They'll take them big old hammers and they'll hit them. So thank you, Barnwood Builders, for inspiring that video. Anyway, you all, one of the best ways to use these things. Now, Mike, how do you know this? Well, just over the years, you learn this stuff. An old man years ago actually taught me how to do this when I got my chainsaw hung in a log one time. He took my double-bitted axe, or my pole axe. His name was Mick Massey, by the way, Bluefield, West Virginia. He said, Mike, I'll show you how to get that out of there because I didn't have any metal wedges with me. He took my axe. And he took a dogwood tree, he cut it down, and he stood there and chopped out gluts, or wooden wedges, to drive in that log to get my saw out of it, and I was really impressed. Things balance just right, you all. But what I'll do is I'll wait till this shrinks down and everything gets good and tight. Then I'll put this in some water. I'll straighten that handle out. And it'll be good to go. All right, you all, one other thing I want to do is I want to thank you all for the birthday wishes. My birthday is on July the 16th. So they're just a couple of days early. But anyway, I really appreciate each and every one of you. I'm 70 years old now. If I live till Saturday, that's all because of Jesus Christ. Make no mistake about it. Jesus is the reason that you can live your life, okay, and live it right. So if you haven't given your heart to him yet, why don't you consider doing that right now while I'm talking? Because Jesus is the answer to your problems. He really is. And your problems are way bigger than physical, you all. Your problems end up in life being mental more than they are physical. Anyway, you all, it's another tip from your Bland County Survival Man. Have yourself a wonderful and blessed day.